A very good morning to you. Praise the Lord, my dear brothers and sisters.
Praise the Lord. Very good morning to you, good brothers and good sisters.
Today is a very, very different question. Okay? You would like to know how you became a priest. Now, you know, my brothers and sisters, all of us, when we are born, when we start growing, each of us has an ambition. I wanted to be a businessman, somebody else wanted to be a professor, somebody else wanted to be a movie actor, etc., movie director, etc., etc., etc. But Father, I would ask you, how did you choose becoming a priest?
So I shall answer this beginning with my life.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I was born in 1973. We are 11 children to my parents.
Wow.
Okay. I'm the 10th in the family.
Big family. Yeah.
Yeah. We are 5 girls and 6 boys.
Right.
I'm the 10th in the family. Okay. I have my younger brother who follows me.
Yeah.
Okay. There are a lot of things that God is providently working in my life, which I just recall back and reflect and meditate on that God has a plan for me.
Correct.
Okay. Now, in the year 1973, I was born. In 1974, there was flood.
Right.
And a whole village was almost like those who were in the coastal area were washed out.
Correct.
And my father was busy helping the people in the lower areas of the village, you know, rescuing them and leading, taking them to the safer place, because we had the boat.
In Bangalore?
Yeah, in my home village.
Okay.
Yeah. And he forgot my mother, myself, baby in my mother's arms, not even 1 year.
Wow.
And my one brother and sister were inside the house. And those days, I am coming from a very poor family. Our house was built with clay, not with stones.
Oh my God. Okay.
And the waters increased. It seems my mother was holding me in her arms. The water was up to her waist or even above that. And my one brother and sister struggling, you know, the water was up to their neck.
Oh.
And because the house was built with clay, with the flood waters, because of the current,
correct,
one of the walls of the kitchen collapsed.
Oh God.
And that is the moment when mother and my brother and sister screamed. But my father was not around. He was still rescuing the people. Okay.
My
father's friend was a Hindu. He heard the scream and he located it's coming from this place. But that man has got a boat, so why the people are screaming there? They would have been rescued by now.
I know.
He did not want to come, it seems, but something prompted him. So he just took his boat and came to our home and he found us caught inside the house. So then he put us in the boat and he rowed only once. And from the other side, my father arrived and the whole house collapsed.
God
had miraculously saved me at this moment. Then from then time onwards, I can recall there were many incidents that God had saved me from water. At least 5-6 incidents are there in my life where I was been saved, even before I was ordained and even after my ordination.
Okay.
And also before the ordination, from the road accidents, God had saved me. So that means God has a special plan in my life, that I believe.
Correct.
Okay. As I said, I was born in a very poor family. My father was a very hard working person.
Correct.
And he was working for one island in the river.
Right.
That belonged to another church, our neighboring church.
Yeah.
One day it so happened, I was in 7th standard. My mother just, we were waiting for the postman, whether my brothers or sisters are written in a letter. No? So waiting for the postman. The postman came and as he was coming, he just waved the hand and said, no letters for you today. So mother felt very bad because brother or sister, nobody has written a letter. And she said, I wish at least you would become a priest and pray for our family. So that was the first inspiration or the hint from my mother to be a priest. Okay. That passed on. Then after that, as I completed my 7th standard, I requested my father that I want to go and do some work during holidays. There was one factory where they make the ropes with the fiber.
Yes.
And they actually support the school children and they give the good pay. The children can work during holidays and they support the children's school fees. It was a good factory.
Correct.
So my companions were saying that they would be going there. So I asked my father, I want to go there. My father said, no, as long as I'm alive, you will not work for your school fees. You study as much as you want and I will earn and pay for your school fees.
Wonderful.
I said, no, I want to have some experience. And father said, I am your father. I will give you the best experience. Come with me from tomorrow we shall go in the boat, they're taking the stones for that island, because that island every year, because of the floods and the current in the water, yes, would be washed out every year. To protect it, we had to put stones and build it.
Correct.
And every year, like, you know, like 300-350 trucks of stones were been carried for that island to build it. So my father was the person who was in charge of building that and right, carrying the stones and working for that island.
Okay.
So I was going with him every day and coming, and the persons, the vice president of the parish council of that parish and the parish priest, they had seen me working with my father.
Right.
And that parish priest is still there, is I find him to be a holy person.
Yeah.
Father William Gonsalves is his name.
Okay. And how old is he now?
Now he may be in around 80s.
Wow.
Yeah. But a very holy person.
Praise.
Yeah.
Praise.
He spoke to my father, and also the same words spoken by his vice president of the parish council, that you have got 11 children, why can't you give one of them to the church?
Beautiful.
Okay. So that father also came and spoke those things in front of me.
Correct.
Okay, so two.
Two.
Then as I was in the high school, I was altar boy from my 7th standard honors.
Correct.
Our teacher was teaching catechism, sister.
Right.
She said one day in our catechism class, I am a sister, religious nun. She is no more, of late memory, one of the wonderful sisters, my Hindi teacher, Sister Gulalmina.
Oh.
Yeah. She said, I am a sister, I am with my religious dress, but when the mass is celebrated, I am away from the altar.
Correct.
But you are just boys. But you are, as altar boys, you are very close to the altar when the sacrifice is offered.
Correct.
So when the priest lifts the host and the wine, just to pray to Jesus, Jesus, just call me that one day I too may offer this sacrifice.
Wonderful.
So she was another great inspiration.
Great, great.
Of course, as we are in the high school, there are a lot of fishermen coming to fishers, the vocation animators.
Yeah.
But I never had the idea that there's diocesan priests, then there are religious priests. Among the religious, there are many congregations, orders. I had absolutely no idea about it.
Correct.
So everyone who came to ask, to look for the boys, you know, to gave their forms, everybody I wrote, yes, I am coming. So practically every day I had the letters from these vocation directors, their materials they would send about their life, all brochures and everything is to come. But I, for everybody I wrote, yes, I am coming. So that was interesting.
Oh.
Then when I went to the 10th standard, I realized that there are different congregations, other different priests are there.
Correct.
So one of the priests directly came to my home from a long distance on the motorbike.
Oh.
And I promised that I would come and join you. And I made all the plans. But when I finished my 10th standard, I had gone to church for a mass. It was Mans Mind, one of my village person passed away.
Yes.
Then I had gone for the mass. I was already ready for the mass. And about to start the mass, the priest of late memory, our Father Daniel de Souza, he was the celebrant for the mass.
Oh.
So he came, he put on the stole and he looked at me. You finished your 10th standard, what do you want to do? I said, I have planned to join the seminary. Come. He took me to his room from there, from the sacristy to the room, and he gave me his visiting card and took down my address, and we came and celebrated the mass. I went away. Third, I received the letter from the Capuchin vocation promoter. You come and join us. And from my parish, it is a Capuchin parish.
Correct.
So all the priests in my parish, they supported me to become a Capuchin.
Okay. Yeah.
I had to become a Dominican.
Oh.
Because that priest who came to my home was a Dominican priest.
Okay.
Okay. Of course, St. Dominic and St. Francis are contemporaries.
Yes.
I think St. Dominic's blessings are on my head also. Therefore, sometimes, you know, that preaching hobby I got. Yes, Dominic is a good preacher.
Yes.
Yeah. So that is how I chose to be a Capuchin, and there was full support for me from my parish.
Right.
Yeah, that is how I joined in 1990. Then we had like 13 years of formation.
Oh.
It's not easy.
13 yeah. years?
13
one
years
three.
Of formation.
Wow.
Yeah, 1-3. So
oh,
to be a priest, because becoming a priest, we have to discern. You have to discern. So this 13 years a long formation, one thing is to know about our call, about the mission that is entrusted to us.
Correct.
And more than that, it is a time to discern also, because you see, when a priest leaves and goes, or a sister comes out of the convent, it is easy to gossip about them, talk about them, criticize them, but we do not know that what those persons are going through
going
in life,
exactly.
Or even through this formation of so many years, okay? It does not mean that we are not discerned. So we are discerned, but maybe God's plans are different. We do not know still. So every day is a moment of discerning for us. So 13 years of formation is needed to be a priest. Of course, in that the main part to be a priest are the last 7 years. The 3 years of philosophy and 4 years of theology. But before that, it is more of our religious formation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but everything is leading towards the goal to become a priest and a religious.
Correct.
Okay, to live your life as priest and religious.
Correct, yeah. Correct.
The vows that we are taking of celibacy, poverty, obedience.
Wow.
Okay, those all are to be practiced in day to day's life. So, all these things we are helped. For example, poverty. A poor person has no place of his own, and we are also called to be obedient. Okay, one of the obedience is that our transfers, that many people are not willing to be transferred.
Yes.
So for us, in order to learn that obedience, in the formation, we are asked to change our rooms. We have got one important year of formation called novitiate.
Yes.
So every month we have to change our room. So we cannot fix anything in that room, because only 1 month you are here. So next month you have to go to the another room.
Lovely.
So that teaches you to obey your superiors and do not let your roots deep.
Deep.
You have to uproot yourself and go to another place.
Wonderful.
Okay. So all these aspects of life, the hard work.
Exactly.
So we have to do all the manual work in our formation.
Wow.
Yeah. So we have to. Yeah. Sometimes we have to cook by ourselves. We are taught.
Oh,
to cook also.
Cook also.
Yeah, you want to clean the cow shed or the pigsty.
Wow.
To work in the garden, dig, cultivate the vegetables.
Oh, great.
So every work is taught for us in the formation.
In those 13 years, yes. Of
13
course.
Years, of course, we have to do those things. And the more important that is given to us as Capuchins, the priority is for us living together. We call our community as a fraternity. Brothers living together. So
Correct.
We are called as brothers. Though I am a priest today,
yes.
That is my office or my mission or ministry. I am a priest for ministry, but more I am a brother. Yes. That is why St. Francis called himself a brother. And that brother also has got a great significance, that he became a brother too. If you remember when I spoke about St. Francis,
yes.
He called the entire universe,
brothers.
All the creatures as his brothers and sisters.
Sisters, yes.
He made himself brother to everybody. So
Correct.
That is important for us to live as brother to each other. So that
Correct.
Is important
Very
aspect
nice.
Of our life. And obedience, even just 1 month before my ordination, my provincial said, we have decided to send you to Uganda. And my answer is, yes, I am ready, I am going.
So, wonderful.
So that is my life. And first 10, 11 years of my ordination I spent in Uganda as a priest. After that I came back 4 years I spent in India, that is in my own hometown,
Mangalore. Yeah.
And now for the past 6 months I am here in UAE.
Praise God. Yeah. Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah. What a journey, yeah?
Yeah.
Father, one question.
Yeah.
You said 13 years in the formation in a Capuchin order. Which is the smallest time taken for any other order to become a priest?
Maybe the diocesan priest, for them it is just 7 years of that philosophy and theology. Of course, there are some initial training in the beginning, maybe 1 year.
Okay.
And also those who join, in those days we used to join after our 10th stand SSLC.
Right.
So then 2 years they'll be in a place where they'll be doing their 11th and 12th standard. That is a moment of also to discern whether to become a priest or not. Like that. So diocesan priests, those who are restricted to a diocese, for them only 7 years, that is important stage of formation. Rest all the religious congregations or the orders, for them it is at least 11 years minimum or more.
Oh.
Yeah. 11 and more, 11 and more.
Fantastic. Solid time of formation. You know, Father, I should tell you a joke now.
Yeah.
As we are closing on this, I was put into a boarding in St. Paul's, Belgaum.
Yeah.
One priest, a very nice and pious priest, I fell in love with him. And one day he went missing.
Yeah.
I didn't know that there used to be a retreat there. Mm. So he had gone for a retreat and I started crying because I couldn't see him. I was so close to him. And then somebody told me, he's in a retreat, he's in that room.
Yeah.
So then I wrote a letter. They say, you can't talk. Mm. You're not to talk. He's totally into a silence. I wrote a letter to him. I love you as a priest. Okay. And one day I will be called as Father Vijay.
Yeah.
And I put the thing in an envelope and sealed it and put it under his door.
Yeah.
When he came out of the retreat, elderly person, very nice person, Father Vincent D'Souza, he said, Vijay, I liked your letter.
Yeah.
You want to become a father?
Yeah.
Good. We will wait till you grow up, until you meet pretty girls in this world. This is what he said.
Yeah.
You know? And fortunately, I got married and you know, all that happened. And he met me after I had two children and he came, Vijay, what did I tell you? You're not to become a father like this. I said, Father, I've not broken my word.
Yeah.
I've become father of two children.
Congratulations.
And he smiled. Yeah. Yeah. But you know, you all are sacrificing so much. You don't have any family life. You don't have any personal life. You all are given. And then what do you get in return? You get brickbats.
Yeah, that is part of life.
That is part of life. And this is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
See, people should also understand, these people, you all are here to serve us, you all are here to help us, and you all are making us grow spiritually. You know, my brothers and sisters, before we say anything to this anointed priest, please think over what type of lives are we leading. We are leading a lap of luxury. We are in a lap of luxury. What are these priests doing? They're just giving themselves to us. Let us be patient with them. Let us be not judging. Let us be there just to bless them, pray for them. That is very important. And that is all I ask for.
Yeah, the most important is pray for us as we pray for every person.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen. Father, give us
The Lord be with you.
And with us forever.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Have a lovely, lovely day. God bless you all.
God bless you all.
Amen. Amen.